Hello and welcome to episode 5 of season 3 of Static, where we take a moment with the brains behind the words at Lifehacker, Gizmodo and Kotaku Australia. Today's episode of Static is brought to you by the Samsung Galaxy Tab Pro S. You no longer need to make compromises when buying a device for work and fun. The 12-inch Samsung Galaxy Tab Pro S 2-in-1, equipped with Windows 10 and 4G connectivity, is the perfect tech companion. This week, the problem with Kickstarter for games. Would you Airbnb your home? What's the worst movie you've ever seen? And we attempt to make tax interesting. I'm so sorry. We also talk to producer of Australia's first Indigenous superhero TV show, A Cleverman. That's Ryan Griffen. Joining me on today's podcast is...
Hey, it's me, Mark, editor of Kotaku Australia. What's up?
Chris, editor of Lifehacker.
I'm Hayley, and I'm the editorial assistant.
So let's talk about the problem with Kickstarter for games. Look, it's something that is incredibly useful for a lot of game developers to get a project off the ground. You've got the advantages of the social media presence that a Kickstarter has. It makes people aware of your game before you've even made it. But there's a certain sense of entitlement that people that donate to your Kickstarter do have, and some say rightly so. What do you guys think about this?
I think it's fair enough to expect something in return, even though it's classed as a donation, the way that the whole funding model is exactly the same as every other funding model, where you give money, you expect a product in return. Just because there's all these, like, you know, like terms and conditions going, well, you're not actually paying for something, you're just contributing to something that might happen. I don't think that makes it okay if the thing doesn't materialize in the end. You have a right to be angry.
Should people not be looking at it, though, as an investment, like, you know, into a business that may or may take off, rather than, say, pre-ordering something?
But it's so easy to see a Kickstarter as like an order page, because literally you're clicking on a thing that says you will get a copy of the game. And even though, you know, Kickstarter has all these, this is not like you're not buying something, you're investing. Mm. People don't see it that way. Like, people still just think they're buying a game.
Is it like maybe a communication problem or a branding problem with Kickstarter?
I just think that, you know, regular consumers aren't in that investment mindset. They're in that consuming, buying mindset.
I think there's a lot of problems with it. It's not an investment because you don't get anything in return. You're not putting money. Mm. If you're like investing in a project, you expect a return. And if you don't get a return, you're going to be angry. With Kickstarter, you don't even get that. Kickstarter is cool for a lot of reasons, but for consumers, it's terrible. Like, you don't have any guarantee that what you spend is going to materialize in anything physical or anything at all that you get back. If that doesn't happen, you get jack shit. If you complain, people say you're entitled. I mean, it's almost like it's just you put money down on a Kickstarter. The only way you win is if you get what you paid for, which you should get anyway. I mean, it's really not a consumer friendly.
And on top of that, there's this really weird kind of fan club culture around it. It's like if you invest in something that's got cultural cachet attached to it, it's like getting the badge. It's like, yeah, I contributed to this one. It's like being part of this community where, like, everyone's like, yeah, we're part of this kind of little kind of fan group that helped kickstart this thing. It's really weird, I think.
Yeah. See, and that's where the gambling in Kickstarters and crowdfunding comes in, because, like, you know, say Oculus Rift, if you were one of the original backers, like, that's great. You get the new, you know, $1,000 version for free. Like, your investment has paid off. Yeah. But it's a gamble. Like, you could go on Kickstarter right now and there will be 8 products that all have the potential to be Oculus Rift. Mm. And, like, maybe 1 in 100 of those products that come up will actually be that. And it is a gamble, and you need to, like, think of it like that.
Yeah, I think that's a good way of looking at it. But you have to pick and choose, you know, like the glory days of just chucking something up in Kickstarter and getting $1 million for just this cool idea are sort of gone. And
I don't know. I don't know if that was ever really a thing.
I don't know.
It helped if you were famous, but yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I'm talking about.
Zach Braff.
I mean, there was at one point Kickstarter existed without that layer of cynicism that we currently have towards it. Like, nowadays, if, like, I mean, take the Tim Schafer one, right? That was the one that really brought it to the consciousness of gamers, right? Like the Broken Age one. People were throwing money at that without even thinking to themselves, this might not be a great idea. At
the time, that's exactly the fan club thing I'm talking about. Yeah. It was like, Tim Schafer, we all want to be part of this thing. And it's like getting the little badge. You know, like in the 80s where you could join the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle Club?
Yeah.
You got like a badge. And like, it's like, it means nothing, but you feel like you're part of something.
But I mean, one of the recent Kickstarter projects that I've personally pledged for was Ukulele, which was the same kind of thing. They're like, guys, we made Banjo. We can't make another Banjo game.
Don't get this guy started.
Don't get me started.
I know, I've talked to him.
No, let's get him started.
Well, here's the thing, right? I mean, this Kickstarter exists in several shades of grey. I mean, there's just so many... It's such a complicated thing, complicated issue. I mean, it's great for certain reasons. It's terrible for other reasons. And it's just everything in between.
But I mean, I've looked at this game. I'm like, it looks cool. It could be a completely boring, absolute clone of Banjo. It could not bring anything interesting. Like, it could be amazing. It could be bad. I've put $40 in it. I'm happy.
$40?
I put $40.
So that's essentially a pre-order. So
if the game comes out, I get a copy of Ukulele on my PS4. If it doesn't, I've lost $40. But I don't know. I feel like $40 for me is enough that like I won't be devastated if I never get anything out of
it. It's reasonably low stakes if you're not putting in like thousands of dollars.
Regular AAA games can be like $120 at launch. So I'd say $40, not too bad.
I reckon my cap would be 20. There's no way I'd put more than 20 bucks into something on Kickstarter.
Another problem I have with Kickstarter is that they should just work out what they believe the funding they need is, and that's it. If they hit that level, it's over. Instead, it just keeps going and going and going. You've got to come up with all these absurd, like, well, we'll add in like 50 more languages. There's all these things that, and it's all completely arbitrary. Like, they're not actually costing it. It's just like, we think if we get another $10,000, we can add this. And it's just all kind of make believe fantasy
stuff.
But what
you find with Kickstarter is that the problem isn't as much the attitudes of the people pledging, but especially with games, the people making the games, because a lot of people who are just kind of getting into the game industry, they've got a great idea, they've got Unity, they've got Unreal Engine 4, like they just don't know how much money
That's
goes into
true.
A game. And
that
you'll find that a lot of Kickstarters die just because they haven't budgeted enough.
Yeah, and then they get completely trashed online and their reputation's ruined. And literally it was just that they had no idea how much it was going to cost
in the
first place.
If you look at Kickstarters that are asking, say, $50,000, it's like that's like one person's minimum wage for a year. So, it's really not that much if you think about it. Like, one of the ones I was watching a while back was Mooncrest, which is a game that was being made by some former BioWare developers that kind of was inspired by Neverwinter Nights mod. It looked really cool. But they were asking for $400,000, which is, because they're all games industry veterans, they know how much money goes into making a game. But, we're used to seeing under $100,000 for Kickstarters and we're like, why do you need this much to, or like not me, but everyone looking at this Kickstarter is thinking, why do you need this much to make a game?
Because they know how much it costs to make a game.
Yep.
It's pretty simple.
Actually, one of the other recent ones that was really interesting is Alice in Road. So that was the PT-inspired game. Went to Kickstarter. I think they were at a point where they were close to the end of their campaign and they weren't looking like they were going to raise the money. They cancelled the Kickstarter and found a publisher. And they actually cancelled their game a week or two ago.
Yeah.
And the reaction from fans has been really interesting. Like, and these are all people who pledged on the original Kickstarter. And even though it was cancelled and even though they didn't spend any money, they've still got that kind of entitlement. And there were people posting on their Facebook pages saying, hey, where can I get my refund? And they haven't given any money and people are asking for a refund. And people are saying, I pledged for you. Like, how can you cancel this game if you started a Kickstarter again? I pledge for you again.
Like they've been betrayed by them going to a publisher and then the publisher fails them and they go, well, we wouldn't have failed you.
Yeah, but just the idea that like if you throw money at something, that's the only obstacle that there can be for being made. Because, a lot of games...
It is annoying that if someone just doesn't properly cost what their project is going to end up being, it's like I think you got a right to be annoyed. It's like, well, you didn't plan for this at all. You got my hopes up.
Yeah, but it's so
like
many...
you've entered into a contract of sorts when you put this on Kickstarter. Like, you're kind of saying, yeah, I believe I've got the plans, the necessary, like, yeah, you know, I know I can do it with this amount of money. And then you're like, I can't do it.
It's difficult with video games because, you know, if something in the code breaks, it's not just something that you can say, all right, I'm going to cost this much to pay a programmer to fix it, because it could take a month to fix, it could take a day, like, you know, game development.
You've got to have those
very
contingencies.
Exactly.
Yeah, very often goes over budget, very often goes over time.
That's like many businesses, though. Like, things happen. Like, you know, you're in a restaurant and plumbing explodes. You've got to kind of have an emergency fund to draw on.
But when people are asking for Kickstarter funding, they'll kind of go for the bottom dollar. Like, they'll be like, I don't want it, you know, especially because if you don't make your funding, you don't get the money. Mm. So they'll go for the bottom amount, and then... even if they get it, you know, there's no guarantee you can make a game for that much.
I just imagine how it would feel, that amount of pressure, having so many people just relying on you to come up with what you've promised. Like, it's a big deal to put yourself on there, and it's almost like it's too accessible in a way.
But that's another problem, because as soon as things start going wrong, a lot of them, they're like, what they do is they put their head in the sand and just suddenly it's radio silence.
Yeah.
That's the worst thing you can do, because you've already opened up this avenue where the fans can talk back to you and you're giving them constant updates. Like, how can you just disappear after creating
also,
this, like, forum? It's crazy.
Even when developers working on a Kickstarter game are just like, I can't remember what it was, but one of them I followed was just like, all right, guys, we're going to work on the game. We're just going to, like, heads down, work on the game. They didn't update for a few months. Mm. But as soon as you stop updating for a Kickstarter game, you will get vitriol from the people who funded it, and you'll get people digging through your internet history and be like, I saw that this company took out a domain for this game that was cancelled and they took money, and I think this is going this way, and it's all pretty crazy.
But there has to be a layer of responsibility, you know? Mm. That's the problem. If you don't, like, you take money from people, I don't care what the situation is, I don't care what the legal implications are, I don't care what Kickstarter is, you've taken money from someone, you need to be responsible to that person. I feel like that's the bottom
But
line.
Also, if you're pledging for a Kickstarter, is it your responsibility to read and take note of the part down the bottom where they have to list risks and challenges, where they say, look, this might happen, this might happen, this might happen, and we might not be able to deliver a game? Like, that's something that that every single Kickstarter has to have.
It all depends.
But people
on...
will scroll past that because they're not interested. They just want this game.
Yeah. I mean, it's an area. Again, it's all areas, shades of grey. I mean, it's all about... I mean, everyone has the role to play, and everyone has to sort of have the right expectations. And it's all about the intentions. There are people out there who are completely exploiting Kickstarter, and there are people out there who have honestly made bad mistakes, bad choices, bad budget, and that's fine. But I just think it's not a consumer friendly thing.
Do you think that maybe Kickstarter needs to change their parameters on what games should be allowed to be funded? Because I know if you're funding like a gadget or something, you have to have a working prototype before you can put it on Kickstarter. So should game developers have to have a playable
a business plan.
That's a great idea.
You can come up with a playable version of something, but if you don't know how to run a business or make or cost a game, that's where people are falling down. These people know how to make games. They don't know how to run a business.
Mm. Always, though. Not always. Some people are just like, enough. I've downloaded Unity. I just need the money to make this game.
Fair enough. What about you guys? What do you think the problem is with Kickstarter games? Is this a problem we can solve? Is it a communication issue? Does Kickstarter need rebranding? Do we need to read fine print? Send us a tweet with the hashtag StaticPodcast. So Airbnb's been around for a while, where you lend out a room of your house or an apartment that you don't use to, you know, tourists that are traveling to your area. Now there's another service called the Car Next Door, where you can hire out your car for hourly increments to complete strangers that obviously have to pass some type of, you know, test to prove that they're not going to smash it into something. But I feel weird about this, and I'm not sure that I'd be comfortable with letting someone into my home, letting someone drive around in my car. I was curious to see how you guys felt about this as well.
No way. There's no way I'd do it. I mean, here's an example. You know when DVD shops used to be a thing, like rental shops? Did you ever see the state of those DVDs? Like how scratched a buggery right? they were? It's like, imagine letting your car out to some stranger who it's not their car. They're not going to look after it properly. It's like
it would
you just
be an insurance nightmare, I feel like.
Yeah.
There's that as well, yeah.
It's not just like the superficial things, like you've bought my car back and it's covered with dents. It's like the wear and tear on your car or the damage that you can't see. Like what if they put oil in the wrong place? What if they put the wrong petrol in it? Like it's those sorts of things that are difficult to track and prove.
They're
that
out,
I'd be
like,
worried about.
Doing donuts and
right? You know, the tires are worn down because they're doing doughies in an oval somewhere. Like I just don't trust people inherently, I think.
See, I'm the opposite.
Really?
I love this stuff. I love all of this stuff.
You'd lend
sharing,
out your stuff.
Ride sharing. Like, I actually really don't like Uber. That's a different thing when I say ride sharing. Stuff like this, though, like Airbnb and the ability for normal human beings to, like, to make money on things like this in a way, it just kind of feels really cool and disruptive to me.
Disruptive. You just said disruptive.
Oh, my God.
But I just
tweet your punishments to Mark.
I just love it. Like, I would totally do it with my car. No one would want to use my shitty-ass car with the used nappies and food at the bottom. But, like, yeah, I would totally be fine with that.
So you like that it's kind of putting power back into the hands of the people rather
correct.
Than
yeah,
big
it's just
conglomerates.
A real
revolutionary.
Yeah, I mean, I just think it's really interesting. Airbnb is super cool because, like, you get to stay in different places and holidays can be a bit more interesting. And, you know, you're not given Donald Trump money to stay in Trump Towers. You're giving, like, you're giving Rae Johnston $200 a night to stay in a really cool apartment
the
or whatever.
The problem is,
no,
though,
you can't.
Most people are garbage.
Yeah.
It's like, how do you trust a complete stranger to look after your stuff?
See, I feel differently. I feel like this is one of the coolest things about the internet because when you think of interactions on the internet, they're almost 100% negative, right?
Mm-hmm.
But with Airbnb, I feel like people have, I've never really heard anything really 100% negative from things like that. You hear a lot of positive stuff. Even with Uber, which I have a lot of issues with, people are really positive about that. It's kind of like one of those things where the internet's been used for good instead of evil, and it's been used to connect people instead of like drive wedges between them. I just feel like it's a really powerful, cool, interesting, unique thing.
I'm always just confused about Airbnb. Like, I've always thought it was, you know, literally just short-term rentals of a property, but like the way that Airbnb sells it is all like, go stay with a family. They sell it like a homestay.
Yeah.
And I'm like, do people really want to be like hosting tourists and driving them around?
No, I don't. I don't think they do that.
Have any of you guys ever done Airbnb?
No.
Because like I haven't, but a lot of my friends do it constantly. I mean, the thing is, it's not like they're staying there like waking up in the morning in their underpants making coffee going, oh, you're awake,
are you? That's what I
imagine,
though.
It's like you're sipping your coffee. It's like they leave. I mean, you stay in that place like it's your own house, basically.
Yeah.
They're not there at the time.
I almost stayed in an Airbnb once. But like, I think I was organizing it like 2 weeks before the event. And then I only heard back from them. Like I sent off, you have to send off an email and be like, can I stay in your house? Use my dates, blah, blah, blah. And, you know, I sent off an email, but I didn't hear back from them until like 2 days before the dates I actually wanted to stay, by which point I had obviously organized alternative accommodation. But yeah, it's kind of, I guess, I feel like I would probably stay in an Airbnb for like maybe a more interesting holiday. You know, they have like tree houses and fun
stuff
like that.
It's definitely more cost effective, like compared to staying at a hotel.
Yeah.
And more interesting.
And more interesting, unless it's heaps far away from the things you need to get to.
Yeah.
But like hotels have maids clean up your shit and it's good.
Yeah. I mean, it's kind of like you're taking a risk. Do you know what I mean? It's like Kickstarter all over again. You're taking this little risk by doing Airbnb, but it's kind of more of an adventure. And I know that's a really shitty little stupid hipster thing to say, but you're doing something a bit different. You're opening yourself up to a different kind of experience. I like stuff like this. My wife sells, like, for example, shit. She sells everything we goddamn own on Gumtree. Like, and I like things like that as well. Like, instead of going to like cash converters were as gross and it's probably been stolen by someone and then taken to cash. You know what I mean? It's like you go to someone's house and they're like, oh, well, I'm not really using this anymore. So here, you have it for a reasonable fee.
Yeah.
And I just love that sort of communal.
So you're talking a lot from the renter's perspective. What about the person who's renting out the house? Would you be comfortable with strangers staying in your house?
I would, if I wasn't there. Like,
but you're obviously, an internet personality, right? So what if you found out that people, you know, that some Kotaku reader had been staying in your house and they'd been like, oh my God, I'm in Mark Serrell's house and they're going through your underwear and they're a bit obsessed with you. And like, is it different if you're kind of more well known?
Totally.
Well, look,
I would never do it for that reason. Like, I feel like that's just a danger zone.
No, I feel comfortable with it.
There you go. Mark Serrels is comfortable with Kotaku readers staying in his home.
Yeah. Oh, no, totally.
You can tweet him if you'd like to organize that.
You can totally go through my underwear. You're not going to find anything interesting.
They're full of porridge.
Use his chin-up bar. It gives you strength.
I like these things. I like the opportunity to make... This gives people an opportunity to make money. Gives people an opportunity to save money. It's communal, it's interesting, it's unique. I just don't see the downside. I mean, the downside is like you get ripped off or what happened to you, Hayley, that sort of thing. But for the most part, this stuff is really cool. I just think it's really interesting, really unique way of using online communication, I think.
I think it's one of those things I'd like to do from the renter's perspective, but being the person actually lending out anything in my home or even my car, like I think... If I, you know, left something in the glove box of my car, I'd be stressing the whole time that they'd looked in the glove box and seen it, like no matter what it was.
Stuff like that just doesn't bother me.
Oh, everything
bothers me. And also, like, the concept, and this sounds really happy, like some happy bullshit, but the concept of things and owning things and this is mine and you can't touch my stuff, I just really don't give a shit about stuff like that.
I think everything you're saying is true, except if something went wrong. Then it would be a huge headache. Yeah. Like if something went wrong in your house, it's just a massive pain.
If someone comes and like throws a giant party. And...
Yeah.
I worry about people complaining as well. I worry about my place or my car or what I've got, like not being up to standard.
Your house stank of shit. Your house is shit. I hear that.
And I'm a bit like, I've got routines. Like I like my house being nice and looking nice. And I'm a bit like that. So I think that probably lends to it. I would walk in and see like a bit of dust on top of a light switch and just go, nope, this room, no, like this is just not good enough for anyone to stay in. I need to clean it for another 5 hours. And I think it'd just be a whole bunch of stress that I wouldn't be able to deal with.
How does Airbnb work? I mean, does it have like a rating system? Because I think that's going to be helpful as well. So like you have some idea that it's like eBay, you know? It's like eBay when eBay started, you're like, I'm not going to spend money on the internet. I won't get my thing. You know, that's what you thought 10 years ago. Yeah. Nowadays, it's like you're so safe. I feel like it would be the same situation with Airbnb, but it's like, oh, I'm scared it might not work. But then you see the 5-star ratings, you see 99 people say, well, I had a great experience here. It was the best place ever. And you're like, okay, click, I'm safe, you know?
But again, this is all from the renter's perspective. What about the guy who owns the house? That's where you have no idea. Like, I'm sure, I think there's a star rating system on the other side as well, isn't there?
Like,
but even so, it's you know, things can go wrong.
Totally. What do you guys think? Would you rent out a room in your house for Airbnb? Would you lend people your car? Are you comfortable with that sort of thing? I'm not sure I am. Send us a tweet with the hashtag StaticPodcast. So we're joined in the studio today by Ryan Griffen. He's a film and television producer and the creator of Cleverman. You may have caught it on ABC or on Sundance TV as well. Thank you very much for joining me, Ryan.
Thanks for having me.
Tell us a little bit about Cleverman. What's the story here? What are we dealing with?
So Cleverman is a story set in the near future. It's a story about creatures from the dreaming making themselves present in modern society and how society deals with that. It's a story about how we treat other people. It's how we treat ourselves. And also about empowering the disenfranchised.
So this is the first Aboriginal superhero TV series, it's fair to say. Why are superheroes so important?
I think for me, superheroes are selfless. You know, they're people who are there to help other people out. They're there to give people hope. And for me, it was a way to tell a story layered with so many political issues, issues about identity, where you can sort of blend them into a superhero world. I think superhero, like comic books or movies, they're the most diverse out of any sort of genre out there. You know, there are superheroes of all different ethnicities. And so it was a perfect fit to start Cleverman in that world.
It does make sense. That's, you're looking at superheroes and, yeah, as you say, they are diverse. You've only got to look at what's happening with Thor and Ms. Marvel. But there have been Aboriginal superheroes depicted in comic books in the past or even just Aboriginal characters, and it's not always complimentary. Sometimes
no,
it's a
not.
Bit of a derogatory way. So having the opportunity, I suppose, to change the representation of Aboriginal people in media, that's a big thing.
Yeah, look, it's actually quite hard to find an Australian superhero that doesn't have links to the Aboriginal culture. You know, it's almost like a lot of these superheroes are a Googled superhero, if you will. It's real, you know, paper thin with the culture and very stereotyped. That's not to say that I don't appreciate to see them on the page. It's just a little bit more digging would help make those characters feel real for me.
Yeah.
And I think that's the most important thing. You know, you get to some of the pages and, you know, they're using weapons and stuff that they, you know, that aren't meant to be weapons or things like that, you know? So it's just really connecting with the culture. And that was a big thing that we wanted to do the whole time through this show.
There are challenges as well with, you know, telling Aboriginal stories. There's certain protocols that need to be followed. You need to speak to the right elders. Did you come up against many of those challenges yourself?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, like the Cleverman himself is quite, it's shrouded in protocols. It's, you know, it is often a taboo topic in a lot of the communities. It's, depending on which community you go to, it's considered men's business. And it's often men's business, you know, even to start a conversation, you have to be initiated and all these sort of things. So it was really hard for us to sort of start that conversation and getting the elders to understand that we're not making, our show doesn't depict a Cleverman. It is inspired by the cultural teachings of a Cleverman and what he represents. And we've created a superhero around that, that is ours. So the Cleverman that you see on screen is the Cleverman for our show and our show only. And once they sort of understood that, they really sort of connected to it. They wanted to open up a lot more. You know, I'd often say to some of the elders that, you know, like imagine a show that's like our own Harry Potter or something like that. And they're like, oh my God, Harry Potter. You know?
That's great.
And then they'd really sort of start to look at it in a different way. And that's when, once we broke down that, that's when the story started to come forward and it made the process so much easier.
I suppose you're probably inspiring a lot of other people to want to tell cultural stories as well. And I feel like, you know, through film or through television or even through games, there's many avenues that we can take to tell our stories that aren't really being utilised. How can we help people and encourage them to do it?
I think for me, it is about telling something new. Like I feel, you know, we're only quite young in the way that Aboriginal stories are told on screen. And, you know, we couldn't have made this show 5, 10 years ago without, you know, some of the films and TV shows that came before us. You know, I'd always talk about, America as an example. You have a look at The Cosby Show, for example. It's a black family, but still quite so relatable to the white audience because he's a doctor and he's, you know, successful and all the kids go to college. But that's like those sort of things are kind of the the way through first to even accept what we're putting on the screen first. And for me, that was what we talked about with Cleverman. It's we didn't, yes, we've got so many social issues in our show, but we've also got action and we've also got sci-fi and we've also got, you know, all the mythical elements in there, and hopefully that they come through first. And then, you know, we have 80% Indigenous cast on the screen. So that alone just will start to see more and more people seeing, you know, like we've got a couple of new people, actors on screen that this is their first job, and just getting them out into on an American screen already is, that's a massive achievement already. And it's those sort of things that I think will help us get past it all.
Yeah, that's awesome. Like being able to, yeah, I've got to ask, like, you've got this idea, you're going to tell this story. How do you get it from in your head to on Sundance TV premiering in America?
It takes a long time, a long, long time. Look, we came up with this concept when my son's 3. He turns 10 this year. So it's been a long road to get there. I think the number one thing is that you need to be quite open to change. You know, originally this show was pitched as a kids series. It was pitched as a show called Dreamtime Detectives. And
I'd read that. If that was a comic, I'd read that.
Yeah, it's about, you know, it was about a young boy who, you know, wanted to uncover mysteries of, you know, why the crow is black or why, you know. So it started as that, and then we started to look at the stories, and a lot of the stories a lot of our dreaming stories are quite brutal, and so you sort of really can't put them on a children's platform.
No,
you know,
couldn't tone them back without, you exactly know, destroying the story.
Exactly, and that's what we didn't want to do. It was we always wanted to stay true to exactly what these stories meant and were told, and so we slowly aged it up and slowly aged it up until we had Sally Riley at the ABC go, look, you throw a whole heap of sex and violence in this and you really want to push it, I'll take it. And so we looked at that and jumped straight into there. And if we felt comfortable, we knew that we could start telling stories that we wanted to tell. We weren't being held back to the restrictions of kids' television. And it just slowly progressed from there. You know, and then we had, you know, we were shooting, we had Pukeko Pictures, which is a sister company to Weta, who did Lord of the Rings. They came on really early during production and before production. And then we also had our international partner come in from Germany, Red Arrow Entertainment, and then Sundance came in. So everyone slowly sort of got there. I think what helped is our stories are so unique. And that's what everyone's looking for in the television climate at the moment. Like, there's so much television out there.
Yeah, and good television.
Good television. And to sort of break through that, you need something unique. Everyone's trying, you know, you can often look at stories and it's just retelling of other stories and all that sort of stuff. But I think what is great is we have such an old culture that no one knows, you know, and we can start picking what we want to put out there into the rest of the world, and I think that's what everyone sort of cling to.
Where can we catch Cleverman?
You can catch Cleverman on ABC at 9:30 on Thursday nights, also on ABC iView or Sundance, and then later this year BBC Three.
Awesome. Thanks very much for chatting to me, Ryan. Appreciate it.
It's okay.
Okay, guys, this is where we attempt to make possibly the most boring but crucial subject in the world to talk about on a podcast remotely interesting. We're going to do this, right? We're talking about tax. It is tax time. Everyone hates it, sticks their head in the sand. We've all been there. We've all done these things. But I'm sure that between us, you know, we've come up with some strategies to make it a bit more bearable every year. Chris, you are nodding. You are like, I've got this.
I'm nodding in sad resignation that we have to talk about this. So going down with the ship. It was the nod that the captain gives as he drowns.
I'm going to watch our analytics for this session of the podcast, and I'm just going
to
see
down to zero.
Everyone has gone, oh, no, 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 no.
Well, I guess who uses an accountant? Let's just start with the obvious question.
Yeah, I do.
I do. Yeah? I didn't used to, but then I did.
Okay. Yeah, I do. It's like, what is How much do you get charged? About $100-ish?
Yeah, roughly.
Yeah, about that.
I think. And do you pay then and there, or do you wait? Do you
I
take it out
the
of your
next
tax
year.
Return?
Yeah, I take it out of the return, of course. Yeah. It's kind of like
it's more, but you don't have to pay straight away.
It's kind of like an agent taking commission for something. It's like, you get me a refund and you'll get your fee. Like, that's kind of.
And
have you
found with accountants, like, do they find really cool things you never thought of, or is it just basically you could have done this yourself? Sometimes it's the opposite. I'm like, I can claim this, right? And they're like, no. I'm like, if I was doing my own taxes, I'd be like,
you would claim it, yeah.
And then no one would have been the wiser. I would have done way more money back.
Yeah,
I always worry that they're claiming stuff that I can't really claim, that I've somehow managed to find a dodgy accountant that I'm not aware that they're dodgy. And they're claiming all these things and I'm going to be audited and there's just going to be problems.
One time I went to an accountant and they worked out what my estimated return was, and it was like huge. I was like, that's awesome. And they're like, yeah, that doesn't look right. And like, it's like they didn't know what they'd done wrong. And I was like, Did you add my hex debt? And like, they're like, oh no, sorry. And they added that on and went right back down. I was like, thanks for nothing, guys. Thanks for getting my hopes up. Yeah.
Dumb.
But no, it is always kind of exciting when someone can find loopholes to give you a refund when you think you're going to pay. Like, I used to just use like the e-tax system started coming in when I first started doing my tax. I'm like, I can do this. I'm really good at this. And then I started a business and just went, I can't do any of this anymore. And especially I was running a solar power company. So there was all things, you know, government incentives, you know, like, there was just
that sounds
so much
a bit
to deal
too complex
with.
To do yourself.
I did try. I looked at it and you know that part of your brain that just switches off when it goes, no, this is too hard. It's like looking at like long division now, like 15 years having done it in school. It's
you just
push
the power down button.
No, it's just going, no, I'm sorry, this is not okay. And you realize that there are professionals that are trained to do this and they should do it and it's worth your time. So that's basically my strategy now, palm it off.
So Hayley, you basically don't do tax, isn't that right?
Yeah, I've only paid tax like 1 year in my life because I've always had casual jobs.
And this is the moment where we all remember how young Hayley is.
Yeah, this is going to be my first year of actually having to think about doing tax.
And how do you feel about this,
Hayley?
People
keep telling me like, oh, you can claim this and claim this as a tax deduction. And I'm like, what's a tax deduction? Actually, no, I had to do tax once. I had to pay tax once. And I worked at a bottle shop, so I could actually claim all of my alcohol that I had bought.
No, can you though?
How is that a work expense?
As a self-education expense.
Wow. What?
So you can't claim a case of beer, but you can claim a nice Italian Sangiovese because I'm tasting.
What
it,
if your
so...
receipts though are all the same exact wine, like your favorite tipple 500 times?
Then you can't claim it. I actually.
So you can only claim it once the same wine
for a whole year.
Okay.
And I'm not sure if I ever repeated a wine.
Okay.
It's worth keeping a spreadsheet for, just future wines, past wines.
Yeah, yeah.
But even doing work, presenting and acting and all that sort of thing, I can claim haircuts. I can claim makeup.
It's some super dodgy ones.
I can claim all sorts of ridiculous things.
One of my mates, he's a part-time comic book writer, so he just claims all his comic books that he buys. It's
I do that with video games. And when the guys, sometimes I've been at doing my taxes and it's a new guy and he's like, you're a video game journalist. And then you laugh. You laugh at that and they're like, that's stupid. That's not a real job. And I'm like, yeah. And I'm going to claim all the video games I bought. And they're like, no.
Are you like, behold my Lizzies? Yeah.
So
unbelievers.
I just that's the point where I'm like, wait a minute, maybe I should get a different accountant.
I claim, I've actually, the last couple of years, I've claimed fast food.
No,
hell yeah,
because it's like amazing. whenever I do a takeaway truth or a taste test for the website, I just keep the receipts and I claim it at tax time.
Do you keep this is the thing I struggle with, actually keeping receipts, because I go through these periods of just purging all the crap that I collect. Like, I just need to get rid of it out of my house.
Yeah, well, there's a multitude of apps which do make it a lot easier. Like, you just keep digital receipts, that's all you need. it's just getting into the habit of actually doing it. As soon as you get the receipt, getting your phone out, taking the photo.
I need to actually do this.
That's a good idea.
Is there an app that you use in particular?
I think there's a few different ones. Zero is the one we use at work.
Yep.
You should all be using that, guys. But there's seriously, if you go onto the Google Play Store or iTunes, there's probably about 50 in Australia you can use.
ATO's official app now does that. It will save your receipts, and then like when you do your tax return, you can just press a button and like send all your deductions into e-tax.
I'm doing that forever. I haven't done. See, I'm going to be honest here. I haven't done my tax in quite a couple of years now.
Mark, you're saying this on a podcast that's going out on the internet. This is really bad.
It's terrible.
We can't edit this out.
I know. It's the worst. And the worst part is like me and my wife have an investment property. We've had it for the last year, so we're doing some baby boomer shit right now. So we need to.
The tax man's taking notes right now.
Well, there we go. I think we've managed to do this. I think we genuinely managed to make.
Wait,
this
one
topic.
More. I think we need one last question because people want to know.
What?
Have you ever claimed something as a work expense, which is just really a bit dodgy, apart from the aforementioned haircuts, which is clearly dodgy?
I was hoping to avoid this before the end. Look, honestly, I don't think I have.
Probably my phone bill.
I'm too paranoid.
Yeah, phone bill is something that's very hard to give a proper estimation. It's like
they say, "Oh, what percentage of you?" And I'm just like, "Oh, 100." I don't actually do that, but you know, you're just like, "I don't know."
It's really hard if you've got a shared bill, like your home internet, because then like your partner will also be claiming a portion. You can't both claim a percent that works out to more than 100. That's just really dodgy. So, yeah.
I just remembered one, which might be dodgy, might not be. It's probably legit, but I felt like it was dodgy because I was doing a lot of working from home, freelancing. I was able to claim a portion of my apartment, the rent on that, as a business expense.
Mm. Yeah. No,
which feels weird, like when you're working from bed. It's like I'm claiming my bed space on tax.
You should have kept your IKEA receipt for your bed.
Totally.
50% of this bed is for
office furniture.
There's so many dodgy loopholes. I've got a friend who works in childcare, and she basically claimed all of her own child's presents, like Christmas presents, birthday presents, as like toys for the business.
No.
But the accountant totally rumbled her. He's like, a lot of expenses here just before Christmas. What's going on there? And she's like, oh, yeah, I just wanted to make the place fun for like Christmas time. And like they totally knew what was going on.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
No, that is dodgy. That is really dodgy.
That's the dodgiest one, yeah.
But I think this segment's been useful. I think we've done this thing. I really do think we have. We talked about tax and it wasn't totally boring.
Great, you're talking to nobody. They've all tuned out.
I'm so sorry, guys. If you're still there and you've got something that you'd like to know about tax, we can probably answer it. So send us a tweet with the hashtag #StaticPodcast. Okay, guys, so now it's time for the moment where we answer your question. If you've got a question for us, send us a tweet with the hashtag #StaticPodcast. Today's question is, what is the worst movie you've ever seen? I'm not even going to say to completion, because I'm going to start. I walked out of Moulin Rouge.
Oh, my God.
Whoa.
I hate that movie, too. I hate that movie as well. Did you walk out of the cinema?
I walked out of the cinema.
Yeah, like I watched it. Oh, my God. I watched that movie with a girl who I liked and I kind of wanted to go out with. And she loved it. And I was just like, I hated it so much. I'm just like, this is shit.
It was like a litmus test for that relationship. I'm sorry.
Backing
if you love
off,
this
man.
Movie, I can't do it.
No, I'm pretty sure McGregor in Moulin Rouge was like the first time I ever had a crush on like anyone.
Oh,
wow. Really?
I was really young.
Have you seen him do Long Way Down and Long Way Round?
Oh, not yet, but
you
I
need
will.
To watch it.
Yes.
It's really good.
But
you'll like him even more after that.
I was really young when that came out. Me and my sisters loved them so much. We used to reenact scenes and film it with our like camcorder. And my sister actually sat down one day, and she wrote out the script for the movie.
Oh my
God! She just sat there, watched the movie, and transcribed it.
Oh God!
I'm sorry,
by hand,
Hayley.
Hayley,
your childhood memories, everything. Complete trash. Because that movie is the worst. Everything, yeah,
I think that
your entire identity is just
Moulin Rouge.
So
Serrels
you actually walked out of the cinema.
I did. I paid
do you
for
remember
a ticket and I walked
what,
out.
Do you remember what scene was the deal breaker for you? You were just like, no, I'm out.
It was the beginning while they were still singing, and I realised the singing probably wasn't going to end anytime soon and it was probably going to continue throughout the rest of the
okay,
show.
But if you're
you
not,
didn't realise it was a musical?
Yeah,
or?
If you're not a fan of
musicals.
Feels
like you're being a bit unfair.
And I'd had it sold to me incorrectly, I believe. Because, right. look, Baz Luhrmann's Romeo and Juliet is one of my favourite films of all time, and I realise now in retrospect that's because he had a really good source material to work with. Mm. Every other Baz Luhrmann film I'm just not a fan of, and I don't know
why. What, you don't
why?
Think Australia is the best movie?
Gosh. Wasn't I was talking to someone at some point that Australia, if it was presented as three like short featurettes
if instead
of one
presented as a charity,
film.
It would feel like it actually made sense.
Let's talk about Moulin Rouge and why it sucks. Just because I want to express why I hate that movie. I want everyone to know, because you watch that movie. This is
because you hate fun.
You sit and you watch these actors, and you know. Do you know what actors are like in real life?
Mm.
They're so fucking annoying. Oh my god, drama school people. Oh my god, all talking over each other.
Now,
oh, they never listen to one
people.
Another. Musical theater people. I'm watching this movie and I'm imagining, what was it like when they hit cut?
I'm
like,
these
people are insufferable.
So you're saying
is insufferable.
It's too in love with itself and with the
absolutely.
Theater.
Absolutely,
yeah.
That's it. It's just like I can just see them after it goes cut. They're like, oh, you were marvelous, Ewan. Oh, Ewan, what a voice! And everyone just talking like in the British accent. Oh, I just kill myself. I just want to kill myself. I'm thinking about that movie.
What hurt me about it was how contrived it was.
Yeah,
and that's the thing that I also, and I know I will be slaughtered for this because I always am. I don't like musicals because there's always something really contrived and fake about people just suddenly bursting into song instead of just continuing their conversation like a normal person.
See, a lot of people feel that way. I don't necessarily hate all musicals, but I definitely hate that musical.
Yeah.
Next week on Static, the musical edition.
Someone else is hosting because Ray is not on it.
Yeah.
I can't do it.
That's not the movie I hate though. What's the movie you hate? I want to talk about the movie I hate. I would dominate this.
I'd go with pretty much anything starring a kid. Like, even though I have kids,
God.
I hate them.
Like Michael
and all of them. I don't. Maybe the
Stand
my girl.
By me.
No. Okay, Stand by Me is the exception to the rule.
Yes.
Stand by Me is awesome.
Found one.
I'm talking more about where the kind of half the reason the movie exists is because the kid is young and cute.
Home Alone.
Nah, Home Alone's less contrived.
I'm coming up, sorry.
No, I'm tapping up.
Ripping my argument to shreds? Okay, fine. There are about 6,000 exceptions to my rule, but I hate movies with kids.
You're talking about more contrived shit like Richie Rich or...
Yeah, that stuff.
Where the kid is a vehicle.
Yeah,
it's like
second line is a zinger where people are supposed to be laughing at
just because
it's a kid saying. I think
the worst kid in movies ever was that kid in The Babadook.
No.
He was the worst. Oh my god! But yeah, talking about The Babadook, I have so many terrible movies that I've watched.
Segway from Hayley.
Yes, because I watch a lot of horror movies, and 90% of horror movies are completely awful. Like seriously, scroll through the horror section on Netflix, and like if you find something with above one star, you're like, oh my god, this must be amazing. So there's one we watched the other night, which is called They're Watching. And it's about like a crew of, it's a found footage one, which you already know is going to be terrible. It's a crew of like one of those home renovation shows where they're like, she's bought a dodgy old cabin in the woods and we're coming back 6 months later to see what she's done with it. And they're also in like Slovakia or something. And half the movie is just like creepy peasants just staring at them because like Eastern European people are apparently creepy.
Yeah.
It's now apparent.
There's this weird subplot where like the cameraman served in Iraq and everyone keeps being like, what did you see when you were in Iraq? And he's like, I will never tell. And then in the end, he's like, when I was in Iraq, a kid got shot and I didn't do anything. And then he dies. And that's the end of that whole subplot that they were carrying out throughout the entire movie. It was just, oh yeah. And then like the last 10 minutes is just like, they reveal that, like, I'm spoiling this because no one's ever going to
watch it.
Awful. Yeah, so they reveal that the character who was renovating the house is actually a witch. And the last 10 minutes is just her going on this terrible CG-fueled rampage through the forest. And she's just walking through the forest and, like, lightning out her hands. And
who's filming and why?
She gets the dude and she's like, you are the witness to my ascension, and like makes her follow him, like makes him follow her with the camera as she's like zapping lightning at the rest of his crew members and all the Slovakian peasants.
Wow. So far this is pretty predictable. You know, Ray hates the movie with music in it. You know, Chris just hates anything with contrived children. Hayley hates a crappy horror film.
Mark. Yes, thank you. Okay, I'm glad you didn't forget about this.
Mark hates fun.
I really...
Mark just hates movies.
Even though I don't like a lot of movies, and I generally just watch documentaries because I'm an old man, and I've never walked out of the cinema because a movie's been dreadful. The closest I've come is one that probably people will be surprised by, and it's Scott Pilgrim.
Yeah,
you're inhaling sharply. Is that because you like it, or because you agree?
No, that was the collective internet just throwing things at the whatever they're listening to this on.
It's just the same shit, right? It's the same problem I have with Moulin Rouge, where I just imagine people who like video games and people who like their culture watching this going, this is for us. He killed someone and he turned into coins because video games have coins.
Okay,
I'm just like, oh, fuck, that sucks.
I don't mind Scott Pilgrim, but the worst thing to come out of Scott Pilgrim is Ramona. And, okay, I saw...
Pixie Dream Girl.
Yeah, exactly.
90%. It's just...
One of my friends posted a Ramona cosplay picture and she had like 8 comments of people being like, you're cosplaying my wife.
My
and it's
life
just food. Creepy. Like just the culture behind that movie and behind Ramona is creepy as hell.
See, that's a large part of why I don't like it as well. It's just like, oh, this is what I'm like. This is my life. I'm Scott. I'm just like Scott Pilgrim.
Oh, no, regular person.
Well, I cosplayed as Vegan Police. Does that count?
That's good.
That was fun.
Yeah. I mean, that movie's
a lot of your hate, I think, is to do with the hype. It was seriously overhyped when it came out.
Mm.
When it was like, even the source material, it wasn't that great. It was like this weird Canadian comic book.
But like, you guys talk about walking out of movies, and just I can't do that.
No, I've never.
No matter how bad a movie is, I have to finish it because I have to know if it gets better. And even if it doesn't, I've seen it and I know that it doesn't get better.
I had to.
Like,
I knew.
I made all my friends finish watching the Star Wars Holiday Special. Like you get like half an hour in, and you're like, this is the worst thing I've ever seen in my life. And I'm like, we have to finish this. This is a rite of passage. We have to finish this. Like, yeah.
I think like the things that I tend to dislike are things that a lot of people like because I like,
because
I just
you're
don't,
a hipster, Mark.
Yeah, because I just don't like, the thought of people enjoying, I think are the reasons why they like it. And
the
and
thought
that,
of people
that
having
me.
Fun just makes you like shrivel up inside.
Like, for example, like Big Hero 6, right? That is a good movie, right? I know everyone's like, holy shit, Mark, take it back, dial it back a notch. I recognize, for example, that Big Hero 6 and Zootopia are good movies, but it's like people just don't see what's wrong with them. So I really feel the need to like make people real, especially
so
Big Hero 6.
Basically, you're saying you have sick hate fantasies about fans and that's why you don't like movies.
I think I think you're like, pretty much the
only one. Like, I wasn't quiet about the fact that I didn't think that The Force Awakens was, you know, as good as the internet thought it was.
Yeah.
And but like, yeah, it's just this manic. Everyone's like, you can't say anything bad about my Star Wars.
Yeah.
And I'm like, but also the prequel had its good moments. And people are like,
well, there we go. Mark just hates things that other people
I
like.
Pretty much do. It's true.
What about you guys? What's the worst movie you've ever seen? This doesn't even need to be a bad thing. Sometimes terrible movies can be lots of fun. We'd like to see what you think. Send us a tweet with the hashtag #StaticPodcast. So now it's time when we turn to Lifehacker to find out, is it legal? I feel like this needs like confetti around us as we find it out. Some sort of game show entrance.
Like gavels flying.
Right? Yeah. Chris, what have you got for us today?
Okay, so you all know that parking across someone else's driveway and blocking them in is illegal, right?
Sure.
But is it legal to do that with your own driveway?
It should be. Yeah.
It should be. It's your driveway.
But is there a difference between like parking across your driveway and parking in your driveway?
Yeah, like is it just the position of the car? I don't.
I haven't even told you if it's illegal yet.
Okay.
But
what do you think?
I feel like it's probably illegal if you're parking on the road, but legal if you're parking in your driveway.
I feel like I'm changing my thing because the reason I'm changing it is because like if you're a traffic person or a guy that gives a fine.
Yeah, how do you know?
How do you know?
Yeah.
So I'm going to say that it's illegal.
But then you could
that.
Just contest it if it was legal.
Yeah, maybe, but...
All right, anyway, it is 100% illegal because there are reasons other than blocking someone in their property why you're not allowed to do it. There's the
nanny
fact
state.
That you it stops emergency services from getting inside your property if they need to. It can also, your next door neighbor, if they're pulling out, you could be blocking their view of the rest of the street. So there's a whole bunch of reasons why you're not allowed to do it. Plus, you don't actually legally own that part, like the boundary next to your property, like right next to your driveway. That belongs to the council. It doesn't belong to you.
So can you park in your driveway?
You can park in your driveway as long as it's still the other vehicles can get access to, like, inside your property, like ambulances, for instance.
I think this might be the first genuine, straight down the line, clear cut. This is actually either illegal or not legal.
Usually we're like, it's a grey area. So why did you bring it up?
You can't park and block your own driveway. We have learnt something here today. If there's something in your life where you're like, I don't know if I should be doing this thing, can I be charged and arrested for it? We might know the answer, so you should let us know. Send us a tweet with the hashtag #StaticPodcast. And thanks again to our panellists for being part of the show today. Static is an Alua Media production brought to you thanks to the Samsung Galaxy Tab Pro S from the X Studio in Sydney. Music is by Danny Allen, designed by Shania Bulgens, and editing by Tiffany Roma. Don't forget to subscribe. We're on YouTube, iTunes, Pocket Cast, Xcast, all the places. I'm Rae Johnston, and I will see you next time.